Pinamo ni Senator Alan Peter Cayetano si Vice President Lenny Robredo na itigil na umano ang pangangampanya at pag-iisip sa posisyon ng Pangulo. Sa halip, hinimok ni Cayetano si Robredo na makipagtulungan na lamang sa kasalukuyang administrasyon sa pag-akit ng mga mamumuhunan, pagtatayo ng mga infrastruktura at paglikha ng maraming trabaho. Dagdag pa ni Cayetano, dapat nihikayati ni Robredo ang mga kasamahan nito sa Liberal Party na sangkot umano sa paglaganap ng droga sa bansa na magbitiw at magpakulong. Ginawa ni Cayetano ang pahayag matapos siyang hamunin ni Robredo na magsalita laban sa pamilya Marcos makaraang maihimlay sa libingan ng mga bayani ang dating Pangulong Ferdinand Marcos sa pamamagitan ng basbas ang Pangulong Duterte. Matatandaan si Cayetano ay ang natalong running mate ni Pangulong Duterte noong 2016 elections.
Including jokes about your legs, etc. You know. And then the latest that we hear from you is that you are still inclined or are still able to work with the president. We would like to know, in what areas would you still be able to work with the president?
I think being able to work with the president is not exactly the correct term. I think I said this during the interview yesterday in Surigao, that as far as housing is concerned, there are still so many things that we need to do. And I would be very willing to provide inputs. I would be very willing to share whatever I have learned from the 5 months I've been with HODSI to either the President or Secretary June Nevasco. You know, I liken it to my leaving HODSI. I liken it to a mother giving birth to a baby, and just after she gave birth to the baby, iniwan niya na. Ganun yung pakiramdam. And I would have to admit that I'm extremely worried of what will happen, in the sense that there is a lot of urgency as far as housing situation is concerned. And I think, kahit wala na po ako, kahit wala na ako sa HODSI, I am very much willing to share whatever we have learned. In fact, when I was in Compostela Valley on Tuesday, I was asking my staff if we can get an appointment with CABSEC Evasco on Wednesday when I arrived, so that I can turn over to him our terminal report. Tingin ko lang po kasi we should waste no time eh. I was spending so many hours for housing. Nag-worry lang ako. Unang-una si CABSEC Evasco, maraming ibang assignments. Nag-worry lang ako na baka walang focus masyado sa housing. And yung mga problema niya parang can't wait eh. So ako in that context, parang I am willing to share whatever I have learned to the administration.
Have you heard back from CABSEC Evasco?
Not yet. We weren't able to get an appointment with him yesterday. Sabi ko po sana, when I get back from the airport, I was suggesting sana that we meet at the HODSI office para naman ma-turn over ko sa kanya for formalities. Pero we weren't able to get one. Ang sabi ko na lang sa office, let's just prepare everything. And kahit hindi na kami magkita, basta ma-turn over namin.
Thank you. The next question is from the Chief of Day Desk of the Philippine Daily Inquirer, Mike Ubak.
Magandang hapon, ma'am. I first met you during the burial of the late Secretary Jessie Robredo, and we were a team of Inquirer were there in Masbate when we got the body. So it's quite some history together covering you and your late husband. My question is, you are a reluctant opposition leader, as the House, the Magnificent Seven says, but by force of history, you are the face of the opposition. How would you reconcile that?
I remember one conversation with Secretary Mar. I don't recall if it was before election day or after. But I remember him telling me, you know, it is already becoming apparent that you have more chance of making it than myself. And you have to remember that if you make it and I don't, you will be heading the Liberal Party. because it's in our constitution that the head of the Liberal Party would be the highest ranking elected official of the party. Naalala ko yung sinabi ko kay Secretary Mar noon. Sabi ko, Sec Mar, tingin ko mas madali pang maging vice president kaysa mag-head sa partido. And I was saying it because I never considered myself a politician. Hindi ako partidista. Ang gusto ko sabihin, the only reason why I joined the Liberal Party was because it was the party of my husband. But I was never involved in its operations. I didn't know a thing about how a political party works. And then it happened. I won. Secretary Mar didn't. So under the constitution of the party, I would become the head of the party. And a few, I think a month or so after I already won, they reminded me again that you are already supposed to lead the party. And I said, I would have preferred na ano na lang ako. Parang would lead the party by title, pero yung day-to-day operations, I would have preferred that it be taken up by somebody else. Na mas deserving, mas nasa posisyon para mag-lead ng party. Kasi I don't think, relative to the other members of the party, I'm a newbie. Talagang bago. Wala ako masyadong alam. And it's good that pinakinggan naman ako ng party leaders. And we have decided to ask Senator Kiko Pangilinan to be the interim president of the party. Ako, ano na lang ako, chairman. Yung chairman, mas ano ka lang eh. Mas, I wouldn't exactly call it titular, pero you're not involved in the day-to-day party operations. Hirap ako dun sa partido kasi yun nga, parang I only became a member of party, not in the manner that the other members became one, but ako because I took after my husband. And I think it would still need a good few years para.
But ma'am, it's also possible to define the opposition beyond mere parties. So for instance, opposition to the burial of the Marcos remains. I mean, people look to you as the leader. How do you?
Actually, we have been pretty much clear about that. I told them that my decision is I would be opposing. And this time, I think with more vigor, with more passion, the issues I do not agree with. Extrajudicial killings, reimposition of the death penalty, lowering the age of criminal liability, Marcos burial, etc. In that aspect, I would be very much willing to be the face of the opposition. When I say that it will be with more vigor now, because admittedly, when I was still a member of the cabinet, although I would issue statements about my opposition to some of the president's policies, I was more careful in treading the path. I did not want to come across as challenging the authority of the president. Gusto kong ipahayag yung aking paniniwala sa mga issues without making it appear like I was challenging the president. Pero ngayon, wala na yung factor na yun. So sabi ko, mas buwelo na ngayon.
The next question is from PDI senior reporter Nicolette Dizon.
So ma'am, sorry, I have to ask two questions because one is a follow-up to what you just said. So beyond being just the opposition leader, I think people are thinking more as you will be the unifying force among all those who are critical of the president. And I think it's clear naman na it's not an ouster that people want.
Oo naman.
It's being critical of all his policies. And can you be that unifying force for
Oo
all
naman.
These sectors?
Oo naman. Sabi ko nga, now that I have more elbow room to do that, talagang gusto kong i-pursue. Kasi ngayon marami naman nag-o-oppose, pero parang all the voices are discordant. Diba? Parang all the voices opposing it are discordant. And we really need a unified stand for the president to listen to us. Ngayon parang walang ganun. Yesterday the death penalty bill was passed in the committee level without so much fanfare, 'di ba? Parang nangyayari 'yon kasi walang masyadong maingay na opposition. And we need to I recognize the fact that we need to change that now.
Ma'am, yeah, since you mentioned death penalty already, si Speaker Alvarez is now saying that he's reminding you that the Constitution actually allows for the death penalty for certain crimes. And you might have forgotten that by focusing, and that the death penalty wasn't effective because there was no political will.
Alam mo, baka kailangan din natin i-remind si Speaker Alvarez. Basahin yung Constitution. Actually, nakalagay sa Constitution, yung reimposition of the death penalty is actually an exception. Diba? Parang sinasabi niya na as a matter of policy, hindi tayo nag-a-adhere to the death penalty, but Congress can pass a law reimposing it on heinous crimes. Ano ito? Hindi gustong sabihin na because it is not prohibited by the Constitution, tama na. Yung sa atin naman, kahit naman yung lowering of the age of criminal liability, pwede din naman yung gawin, pero hindi gustong sabihin na tama yun. Kasi kontra yun sa mga wala natin. Halimbawa, meron tayong mga pulisiya sa konstitusyon, meron tayong mga paniniwala sa konstitusyon na tingin natin sa lungat pag nireimpose ang death penalty. Yung imposition of cruel, inhuman, and degrading punishment, bawal yun sa ating konstitusyon. While binibigyan tayo ng window para yung Kongreso pwede yung ipasa, yung sa atin lang naman, lahat tayo malaya magdebate. Pero hindi natin gusto na hindi binibigyan ng pagkakataon pagdebatehan sa Kongreso. If we look at how the death penalty bill was passed at the committee level, medyo nakaka-insulto yata sa atin yon. Kasi walang debate, hindi nga nag-present ng mga resource speakers para ipakita kung mabuti ba o hindi ba mabuti yung death penalty. Parang iusapan lang kagustuhan ito ng pangulo kaya ipasa natin. Pag ganun na yung linya ng usapan, ginagawa ng Kongreso kasi kagustuhan ng pangulo. Ano na yung saysay ng separation of powers natin? Actually, ito very dangerous sa integrity ng ating institutions. Pag yung linya na ng executive, ng legislative, saka judiciary ay masyado nang muddled, ano to, parang threat itong napakalaki sa ating demokrasya.
So ma'am, candid language, like nakaka-insulto to sa atin, is part of the liberation of Lenny Robredo?
Sinasabi ko naman yun dyan dati. Pero you know, I was really insulted by the fact that the bill was passed in that manner at the committee level. Hindi man lang binigyan ng pagkakataon pagdebatihan. Yun lang naman sa akin. And I hope it doesn't happen in the plenary.
The next question is from Inquirer.net, reporter Julian Love de Jesus.
Yeah, hi ma'am. Ma'am, you've mentioned before that you've been getting text messages and tweets from Bongbong's camp saying goodbye to you. Aside from that, ma'am, do you have a specific basis to claim that there is indeed a plot to unseat you? And if yes, ma'am, do you think President Duterte has a hand in it po?
Ako, I cannot say as far as the last question is concerned. Pero yung mga indications, marami na. I have actually been warned several times already that there are people around the president, some are even members of the cabinet, who are pushing for Bongbong Marcos. Pero yung sa akin, from the very start, hindi ko yun pinapansin kasi parati kong sinasabi na wag natin yung pansinin, mag-focus tayo sa trabaho because we don't have a lot of time. If you recall, when the president went to China, kasama niya si Bongbong Marcos, pinakilala niya, ito yung susunod na VP. Insulto din yun dyan, di ba? Insulto din yon, pero I decided to, di ba, I decided to relegate the insult in the back burner and just focus on the work at hand. after nagkita kami ni Presidente during the cabinet meeting when he returned to China, wala akong sinabi. I was still the same cooperative member of the cabinet to him. Kasi tingin ko, there were more pressing issues at hand. Pero yung sa akin lang, yung pinaka nag-alala lang ako. Kasi I think I already mentioned this during the press con the other day. Na on Saturday, when there were very, very few people, there were very, very few people who knew of the text message I got. Wala pa nga, I was still waiting for a confirmation from the president. Meron na silang tweets na would indicate that they were in the know. Nakakatakot yon. Kasi gusto sabihin, parang kino-confirm niya na talagang ano siya, yung links niya nasa loob talaga. Ito lang, the reason why I mentioned this is that I think it is time for us to be vigilant. Kasi pag, hindi lang naman ako ito eh. Hindi lang naman pag nag-succeed sila in doing what they want to do, it's not just about me, but it is about so many other things involving our country. Remember na hanggang ngayon hindi pa natin nababawi yung mga nakaw na yaman, and hindi pa nga natin yun nababawi, wala pang retribution, wala pang acceptance. Parang gumagawa na naman ng bagong wave nung kung paano din nila ginawa yung kanilang pang-aapi sa ating bansa noon. And it so happened na now ako yung nakaharang sa kanya. Kaya yung sa akin naman, I will do whatever I can para harangin yung binabalak nilang gawin.
The next question is from Radyo Inquirer, Alvin Barcelona.
Magandang hapon po, Vice
Magandang
President.
Magandang hapon.
You mentioned earlier that you have time to spare now, no? And you also mentioned that you're willing to take on the role of the leader of the opposition. Do you have any plans of joining any anti-Marcos protests or upcoming protests?
Ako nothing solid now, but it's not impossible that I will join one of those. Pero tingin ko more than the rallies, tingin ko yung pinakatulong ko talaga maging unified yung boses natin lahat. How to do that, kailangan pag-usapan in the next few days. Pero I think now, kasi walang ano yon, parang walang isang tao na bringing all us together. So I think that will be what I would want to be in the next few days. Para maging unifying voice of all those who want to express their either disgust or opposition to the policies of this administration.
Ma'am, literally the next few days, or are you talking about?
Kasi every day something's happening, di ba? Every day something's happening. Halimbawa, yesterday there was an NBI report already saying that Mayor Espinosa was really murdered, and then yesterday, the day the investigation report came out, the president gives a statement na parang relegating also the report in the background and assuring those cops that they will be beyond the reach of the law. It's scary. Kasi ano yung ini-imply niya? Wala na tayong rule of law. Those things. Parang nauunahan niya nga yung parang dahil ang bilis ng turn of events, kailangan din bilisan natin yung pagiging vigilant.
Thank you. The next question is from Inquirer Bandera, Billy Vegas.
Ma'am, magandang hapon po.
Magandang hapon.
Ma'am, sabi po ni Speaker, wala raw po kayong dapat na ipangamba kung talagang kayo yung nanalo noong nakaraang eleksyon. So, kinakabahan ka po ba? And why?
Maybe, ma'am, you can talk to us about the status of the election process.
Bawal kasi. Bawal kasi ang pag-usapan. We have been warned not to talk about the case before the media. I wish I could. Pero bawal. Yung sa akin lang, kaya ako din sinasabi ng maging vigilant, kasi they're really doing everything that they can. We trust the Supreme Court. Sana until the end, hindi maputol yung trust na yon. Kasi sa akin naman, pag-ayusin lang, pag-bigyan lang, I'm sorry, John. I'm having a hard time. Hindi ko alam kung paano ko ikukwento na hindi ko binabalga yung yung sa akin lang. Kung patas yung laban, I don't think we have anything to worry about. Yun na lang siguro. Kung patas yung laban, I don't think we have anything to worry about. Sana mali yung pangamba ng marami. Sana mali yung kwento na mga naririnig natin. I'm sure most of you have heard stories about the machinations that are being done. Sana hindi yun totoo. You have seen news reports already that most of the affidavits that they submitted were disowned by the affiants. Sana ma-appreciate yung lahat na ma-appreciate yung value ng lahat na information na naanaan dyan. At sana kung meron mang attempts na sirain yung proseso, sana hindi magtagumpay.
Thank you. It looks like we will have time for a second round, no? So after that, I'm going to call on our Southern Luzon Bureau representative. Then after that, we'll have questions from social and from mobile. And then we'll start all over again. All right? So the next question is from Sheena Barameda, all the way from Legazpi.
Maray na hapon po.
Maray na hapon.
Madam, ako po, sa totoo lang, saro po akong proud na ganya. So ang hapot ko po sa indungo niyan, hali po sa mga ano, sa mga Bicolano niya tong mga reporters as in mga correspondent. Ang hapot, ang sa imo po kayang track record na alala niya to, pirmi po nindong sinasabi na kamo po dai ready kang naglaog bilang ano, bila sa politika, ay sa politik o sa politika, kamo po ang sabi po nga ni Nindo, reluctant po kamo ang sa imong eksaktong word na sinasabi. Ngunyan po, sa oposisyon, hinihiling po kamo na kamo ang maging leader o manginotan sa mga ano sa oposisyon ngunyan. Alagad igwaman po giraray na mga miyembros kan oposisyon andai po nagtutubod na ika ang dapat na manginotan sa inda. Ninhuli po digdi sa naging track record po nindo na para po sa inda nagpapahiling na kamo po dai po daa kamo independyente considering kamo po daa saro sa naman na ginagamit po kan sa indong partido. Ano po ang masasabi nindo sa inda tanganing sinda po makumbinsi na kamo po independyente?
I'm sorry.
Pwede bang Bicol
yes,
din ba?
Yes ma'am, but then you have to have an immediate translation.
Ayan. Mahirap mo sumagot ng Tagalog pag Bicol yung tanong. Sa kuya, sa hiling ko, si record ko din will speak for itself. Naglaog ako bilang Liberal Party member, pero nahiling nindo. You saw me up close, how I conducted myself while I was Congresswoman of Camarines Sur. Yung sa kuya, was there any indication na sunod-sunodan ako sa partido, Mayo? I think even during the campaign, mayong indikasyon na sunod-sunodan ako sa partido. At this time, I think it is also unfair for the Liberal Party to be accused na nagiging sunod-sunuran sa kuya. In the first place, when President Duterte won, halos nalagas si membership kang Liberal Party. Alam ba, at the House of Representatives where I come from, we started with 114 members. 114 Liberal Party members, now it's down to 32. Sa local officials, arog man ka yan. Diba? Kadakol man, Philippine politics. You ally with the party not because of principles, but most of the time, it's because of the person in power. The Liberal Party has not yet met as a party. Since the elections. Sa hiling ko insulto para sabihin na ako nadidiktahan kang partido. Si Sakuyang record, in all the 3 years that I was in Congress, dawa si pagboto sa mga importanteng panukala sa Kongreso, di ako nagsusunod sa party lines. I have always worked independently. Pero I would understand if there is a bit of a hesitation as far as opposition leaders are concerned. Kasi everyone sees me as a neophyte politician. Iyan, that's one thing that I would have to admit. But to claim that I am a minion of the Liberal Party, I think it's unfair. Because my record hasn't shown any indication to that sort. Yun sigurong baguhan, okay yun. Pero nasunod-sunuran, I think it's an unfair accusation.
What is the Bicolano for minion? Hindi ko na... No, ma'am, sorry.
Come to think of it, I don't know.
The next question is from social, our social media director, JV Rufino.
Hello, madam. We have actually had three questions. One from, I'll start with the one from Twitter. Do you have any message for those who support the Dubredo partnership?
For those who?
For those who support the Dubredo partnership.
Ah, Dubredo.
Partnership.
Ano naman ito? I think naman most Filipinos support, di ba? Whoever won the presidency and the vice president presidency. And I think that should be the case. Nung nanalo po kami, I think we also deserve the support kasi it is crucial for us to be able to do our work well. Yung sa akin naman, yung pag-oppose natin, hindi natin ino-oppose ng kahit anong sabihin ng Pangulo. Pero yung ino-oppose natin, yung ibang mga pulisiyang hindi tayo sang-ayon. But as I have said time and again, he also has policies that we support. For example, his fight against ENDO, the Freedom of Information Law, the Freedom of Information Act, yung rehabilitation of drug dependents, yung kanyang tax reform package, those are things that we support. And just because I resigned from the cabinet does not mean na yung lahat na sinasabi niya kukontrahin natin. We'll oppose when there is a need to oppose, and we will support when there is a need to support. Kaya naman siguro yung mga Dubredo supporters, hindi dapat mangamba. Kasi yung pinag-aawayan naman namin mga issues, hindi naman kami I hope that is the case. Hindi naman kami nag-aaway na kami dalawa.
Okay. Then the second question, you were mentioning before that, you know, you're a neophyte politician but not, you know, hindi sinud-sunuran. So someone was asking if you have any major policy differences with the LP and with the previous...
Yung problema kasi ng LP, alam mo we had a get together last night, yung mga LP sa House of Representatives. Merong Christmas get together, the LP members na natira sa House got together. In-invite ako because I was one of them before. Because we haven't met yet as a party, we don't have any stand yet as a party on those issues. Mm-hmm. So mahirap to say na merong party stand na kontra ako kasi wala pang party stand in any of the issues at hand. Kaya the resolution last night was, siguro pagpasok ng January, we should meet as a party already so that there would be an avenue for us to discuss what would our stand be on the issues at hand.
Okay. Then there's the last question from Viber. This is a private message on Viber. Ma'am, there were posts on the internet with allegations that you were actively sharing details of the cabinet meeting when outside of it, which caused distrust. Is this indeed what happened?
Ako hindi ko alam kung information about cabinet meetings yung sinasabi nila. When I saw that, I also wondered what particular information kaya yung sinasabi nilang shinare ko. Kasi wala akong sinashare na ganun.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. We have about 25 minutes left, so time for a second round. The next question is from our lifestyle editor, Thelma San Juan.
Good afternoon. I like to ask, how are you preparing yourself personally for what lies ahead?
Alam mo, when I resigned from the cabinet, parang much of the anxiety among friends was that baka this will already be the start of demolition, demolition jobs against me. Ang tanong ko nga sa kanila, di ba nag-start na matagal na? Lahat na yata may asawa ako dati. I was married to some guy. I had a boyfriend. Buntis. Tapos kahapon sa the other day pala sa Compostela Valley, meron pa palang nagpa-abort. Sabi ko parang, akala ko pang artista lang yung mga kwentong yon. Ano yun? Merong ako yung nagfa-fund ng rallies. Merong, ang ako daw talaga si Vladimir Lenin. I don't know if you saw that. So sabi ko, ano pa kaya? Pero they were warning me, ay nako, lahat yan, lahat gagawin. Especially now that you're no longer a part of cabinet. Yung sa akin, actually I just brushed it off. Ang nasa isip ko lang, I lost my husband at a very unexpected time. Tingin ko wala nang sasakit pa doon. Tingin ko wala nang masihirap pa doon. So, ako personal, I think I'm prepared for anything that will come my way. So, when I went home after I decided, that was on a Sunday night. When I went home, I talked to my children. Sinabi ko na sa kanila na maghanda tayo. Maganda tayo kasi baka nga mangyari na siraan ako ng siraan at madamay pa kayo. Yung sagot ng mga anak ko, pareho ng sagot ko dun sa una sa akin nagsabi. Ang sabi nila, di ba ang tagal ka na nilang sinisiraan? But I think, kaya siguro hindi din kami naapektuhan. Kasi ridiculous talaga yung mga charges. It would have been different siguro if there was some semblance of truth. Pero pag ridiculous kasi yung charges, parang you just laugh it off. We are aware na people who do not know me well, medyo napapapaniwala. Pero I think what is important is that you are not guilty of any of the things they accuse you of.
Does this mean you will spend less time on Facebook?
Hindi. Actually, my friends have been saying, keep off social media. Keep off social media para hindi ka nasasaktan. Pero ako, I would have to admit, hinahanap ko pa yung mga negative na tawag sa akin, Lugaw Lenny. Natatawa ako eh. Natatawa ako doon. I don't really get affected. I don't really get affected by this. Kasi napapansin ko most of them are trolls. Mahalata mo naman. Halimbawa, the day I it was a Sunday when I first put out my statement. Wala pang trolls kasi siguro day off. Walang trolls yung Sunday. Pero nagsabi na kami, starting tomorrow at 8 o'clock in the morning, magsisimula na sila. And true enough. And pag nag... I am sure you... alam nyo na din, you have developed the knack already of identifying the trolls. Pare-pareho yung linya kasi may nag-feed. Diba? And sometimes it's funny. What's more funny now is that yung hindi naman mga trolls, ginagaya-gaya na yung mga sinasabi ng trolls. I don't know if you have seen that on Facebook.
So ma'am, because your demeanor is always smiling, that's your, what will it take to really anger you, to make you angry?
Ako, you know, hindi ko alam kung sasabihin ko to boom. Pero, just on Monday morning,
a few thousand of your close friends.
Pero on Monday morning, I called for my staff, everyone in the office for a general assembly. Just to inform them of the decisions and how it came about. Pero yung sinabi ko sa staff ko, yung what really pisses me off, sinabi ko yun sa kanila. Sabi ko sa kanila, kayo, yung ginagawa nyo sa akin, you always try to make things convenient for me. Understandable naman yun. Ako yung principal. Pero sabi ko, hindi nyo nalalaman na the more you make things convenient for me, yun yung nakaka-piss off sa akin. Lalo na when it inconveniences other people. Halimbawa, when we go to an event, yung advance namin, yung protocol, may mga demands. Pag nalalaman ko yun yung nakaka-blow ng lead ko. Pag nasa traffic kami, nagka-cut yung aking driver, yun yung pinag-aawayan namin every day. Pag nagdo-double park kami na nakaka-cause kami ng traffic, those are the things that really, parang yun yung tagasundot sa akin. Pero other than that, wala eh. I think most of the people who know me, even my children, would know that I am the calmest person. Kahit sa bahay, hindi yata ako nagagalit. Para sa akin, waste of emotions yung magalit. It will take so much for me to blow my lid. Usually, kahapon, on Tuesday, my chief of staff guested in a television program. Kasi wala ako. They were inviting me over, and because I was in Compostela Valley, yung chief of staff ko yung pumunta. And I asked him to send me the link to the interview. I was watching it last night, and he was describing me. Parang ganyan kwento niya, how I reacted to the text message, how I reacted to the phone call yung the night before. Parang ganyan kwento niya yung tono ng boses ko. Na, ganun ba? I am always like that. Napaka-boring kong tao. Pero I am usually always like that. It will take so much for me to get angry.
So no inquiry elevator for you. You have to take the stairs after this. The next question is from Jason Gutierrez.
Hi, ma'am. Jason Gutierrez.
One of our editors.
It's very good to know that you are still calm, no? But it's also nice to see that you are becoming less reticent about what you want to do in the next 6 years. I guess the next question is, how daunting do you think the next years will be as the leader of the opposition?
I think it will be very daunting. It will be very daunting in the sense that there has been a sort of a... Paano ko ba sasabihin? We talked about this already before when we were at the holding room. Parang because I'm coming from the Liberal Party, there is already a stigma that has been assigned to it by so many people. Also because I think some of the things said during the campaign really stuck. Pag sinabing, di ba pag sinasabing yun, dilawan kasi yan, etc., etc., parang it turns off so many people. And I was asked outside, because of that, will you be leaving the Liberal Party? And I said, no. This is the party of my husband, and I intend to stay. Pero siguro, the challenge really is how to become, how to continue being a part of Liberal Party and removing that stigma. Because I think most of the accusations have been unfair. Yung question siguro ngayon is how do I become the unifying voice among the many discordant voices around who believe in the same thing. Pero ako I'm not losing hope kasi I think people now realize what is genuine and what is not. Parang ngayon hindi na din naloloko yung tao. Alam nila kung nagsasabi ka ng totoo, alam nila kung hindi. So I think we have to capitalize on that. Just make people realize that, di ba, parang hindi ka naman, I will use the word again, hindi yun ng partido mo, but you are expressing their voices also, whether they are part of the party I belong to or not. But I know that the task is very daunting. Not only because of that, but also because these are interesting times. These are difficult times. Di ba parang it's been what? 5 months? It's been just 5 months, almost 6. Pero parang sobrang dami na nang nangyari. Paminsan, wala nga tayong panahon to catch our breath. Meron na naman bago. Ang worry ko kasi dito, kung nasasanay na tayo and we accept things as they are. Yun yung worry ko. And the challenge really is, how do you inspire people to care? How do you inspire people to fight? To show their convictions, not to be afraid? How do you encourage people to be courageous with their views? Kasi there is a pervading sense of, nasasanay na eh. araw-araw yung patayan, sanay na tayo eh. Parang ordinaryo na lang. We don't get scandalized by big things anymore. And I think it's scary. So I think the real challenge is, paano mo ba as a leader of the opposition, paano mo ba may encourage yung tao to not stop being courageous, to not stop fighting, to be brave enough to stand up for their convictions.
Before I call on TJ for the next question, I have two quick questions of my own, ma'am. First, 2 weeks ago, we had President Ramos as our guest in this exact same forum. And when we asked him, what advice do you have for the vice president? And we know, and he's very proud that he has supported you. His advice was, stay with the team. Stay with the cabinet. Have you spoken to him since then? Do you plan to speak to him?
I haven't spoken to him since then, but I plan to visit him. I visit him from time to time. My husband has been a big supporter of President Ramos. In fact, before I decided to run, I consulted him. After I decided to run, I consulted him. Before the elections, I visited him. After the elections, I visited him. I have yet to visit him now, but I intend to. Pero 2 weeks ago, I would have told you the same thing, that I would have wished to stay on. So, gaya nga na sabi ko, para ako nanganak na iniwan ko yung sanggol ko. Ako, I would have wished that I was still part of cabinet only because I know the urgency of the situation in housing. Pero even if I wanted to, it has already become very untenable for me to continue, knowing that I am no longer wanted there. It is crucial for me to be able to execute programs in housing, to have the support of not only the president but the entire cabinet. If I don't have that support, parang ang magsasakripisyo naman yung housing sector.
Ma'am, second quick question. Among the vice presidential candidates, you and Senator Cayetano were vocally against Bongbong Marcos. Now, he's a little quiet as far as the Marcos burial is concerned. Do you have a word of advice to Senator Cayetano?
Ako siguro hindi advice. Pero siguro, I would have hoped that yung outrage that he showed during the campaign against the Marcoses would still be the same until now. We would understand that he is fully supportive of the president, but I don't think that's enough reason for him to, di ba, to keep quiet. Lalo na na we all saw how he was fully aware of the sins of the Marcoses against the Filipino people. He was very vocal against it. Before, I think now he should be more vocal about it, knowing that they're doing everything they can to be back in power.
Thank you. May I call on another Inquirer editor, TJ Bergonia.
Hi, ma'am. Good afternoon. Ma'am, just to go back to social media, how do you handle a certain blogger who goes by the name of Mocha Wasson? Do you have your own team of trolls? Or... you just let civil society handle her?
Ako, I don't think I would need trolls to handle her. I would have to admit, hindi ko pa nababasa yung blog niya, and I don't intend to read her blog. Pero I've been told, kasi paminsan may siniscreenshot na mga status sa Facebook about people attacking her also. I don't think we need to hire trolls kasi self-inflicted naman nila yung mga ginagawa nila. Tingin ko kailangan lang yung trolls kung wala kang nahahanap na kakampi. Pero because marami namang like-minded and pareho nating pakiramdam sa mga bagay, tingin ko hindi naman kailangan tayong mag-join the bandwagon.
Okay, we have 10 minutes. The next question is from Juliet.
I just would like to introduce a breaking news from Julian, so we need a quote from the Vice President.
Ma'am, just now, President Duterte is giving a speech in Albay. He said that, "I will assure Lenny and the rest of Bicol that she will be there until the end of her term. There's no such thing as removing the Vice President." Do you have any reaction to that, ma'am?
Maraming salamat. Tingin ko, I would like to see it as a reassurance. Sana hindi lang sa Bicol, sana hindi lang sa Bicol sabihin, but all over the country. But, you know, despite our many differences, I would like to think that the President and I had a very good working relationship. Ano siya? Ako, whenever I attend cabinet meetings, iset aside na natin yung mga biro niya about my legs and whatever else. Whenever I would share with him the lessons that I get from my many field visits, he would respond to them naman during the cabinet meetings. Kaya nasayang ako. I didn't see it coming. I thought, despite our differences, we will be able to transcend them. Tinitingnan ko lang na we'll be able to transcend our differences and we'll be able to work well together. I have mentioned this to him before several times. In fact, I was able to thank him several times. I was telling him, "Mr. President, I would like to thank you that despite our differences, you have not taken my public statements against your policies. You have not taken them personally against me." And one time, he even assured me na hindi yun importante. Yung mahalaga na nagkakatrabaho tayong maayos. So I thought we would be able to hold on for a much longer time. Kaya nasayang din ako.
The next question is from Metro Editor. Is that right? Okay. Vault Contreras.
Good afternoon, madam. We are all getting a sense that a big battle lies ahead for you. So the 14 million voters who put you in the vice presidency would also be interested in seeing who are the forces or the people or the institutions behind you in this battle. In terms of maybe you can cite a few names or sectors or groups who will be standing behind you in this coming challenge to your position.
Ako parang mahirap to pinpoint names at this time. Dahil I think I was sharing this with John earlier that when I resigned, I had a lot of supporters who were also supporters of the president who did not want to be caught in the middle of this. Kasi siguro mahirap in the sense na I think most people, if they have their way, would have wanted the president and myself to work well together. Kaya if you are referring to the protest, ako tingin ko pag napakita na hindi naging fair yung proseso, I think so many people will go out and express their indignation. We have seen this already when the former president was buried at the Libingan ng mga bayani so hurriedly. I think the indignation would be more kung nakita ng tao na yung protesta hindi na-handle ng maayos. And it's not just because they're supportive of me. Tingin ko secondary ako noon. Secondary ako doon. Pero I think mas marami yung lalabas dahil unang-una, yung pagpuwersa na naman ng mga Marcos makabalik. Pangalawa, yung pagyurak sa integrity ng institutions. I think these are things which strike the very core of yung paniniwala ng Filipino people.
Thank you. We have about 7 minutes to go. The next question is from another Inquirer editor, Oliver Tevez.
This question really is your question. You said, how will I be the voice of the opposition? and or how will you unite the opposition, considering the broad spectrum from left to right? Do you have an answer for that at this time?
We are in the process of completing the answers. But I think it is very important that I be very vocal about the things I feel so passionate about. And talk to more people who feel the same. Kasi ngayon, parang yung reklamo ng iba, galit kami pero hindi namin alam kung anong gagawin sunod. Galit kami pero hindi namin alam kung sino yung pupuntahan. And I think the challenge now is how do we encourage people to come out? How do we encourage people to not to be afraid to voice their opposition? Yung sa akin, importante na mapakita ko na hindi ako natatakot. Importante na mapakita ko na for things I truly believe in, it is worth all the risk. It is worth the sacrifice that we're taking. Tingin ko magiging mahirap ito in one sense and madali in another sense. Mahirap dahil we have to tread the political, alam mo yon, web. Pero madali din because alam nyo, alam ko, na marami yung pareho yung pakiramdam. Marami yung pareho yung pakiramdam sa akin. Naghahanap lang talaga ng mapupuntahan. Naghahanap lang ng boses. And again, hindi ito equivalent sa gustong patalsikin si Pangulo. Kasi hindi yun yung sagot eh. If you will ask me, wala akong pangarap maging Pangulo. Wala ako, tingin ko, pag nagkaroon tayo ng another upheaval, lalo na namang gugulo yung sitwasyon. Pero yung gusto natin, pakinggan tayo. Yung gusto natin, yung mga bagay na ayaw natin, i-recognize kung bakit natin ayaw. Yung gusto natin, ipakita na marami tayong umaayaw. Kaya kailangan tayong pakinggan. Hindi yung dahil ayaw natin, ine-equate na sa pagpatalsik. I think that's, yun yung problema ngayon.
And ma'am, do you think that the president has the capacity to listen, to adjust his policy?
Yes. Ako yes. Ako naman, we have seen the president change his mind so many times already. Siguro, hindi, I think it's both a good thing and a bad thing. Diba? It's both a good thing and a bad thing. In the sense na tingin ko pag alam niya kung gaano kahalaga sa atin itong bagay na to, pwede siyang magpalit ng isip. And I think we have to capitalize on that. Iparinig natin sa kanya, ipakita natin sa kanya how much we feel about a particular subject para pakinggan tayo. Ngayon kasi watak-watak yung boses eh, kaya hindi tayo pinapakinggan. So baka pag naipo natin yung mga boses na yun, baka sakaling pakinggan tayo.
Thank you. Our last question is from, sorry, or well, if we have time, we'll have more questions. But the next question is from Chato, our opinion editor.
Ma'am, you show yourself as and people see you as a strong woman. San po galing to? Are you on Zen mode? Are you a Buddhist? Saan ho nyo, according to the millennials, saan ho ang hugot dyan? Sa ano klase?
Ako, I don't really know, ma'am. I don't think I can answer you. Pero buhay pa po yung asawa ko, ganito na ako. Buhay pa yung asawa ko, you know, between the two of us. My husband was the excitable one, was the parang parati niyang kinikwento sa mga anak ko na I am the one who gives him balance dahil sa temperament. I don't know where this came from. Maybe it was an upbringing. Also because I think sanay ako sa hirap. Sanay trabaho na mahirap. When I was a lawyer, I was lawyering for the poor, and I encountered so many difficult circumstances. Halos lahat ng kliyente ko yung binabangga yung mga malalaking tao. Siguro training na din yon. Training na din yon. Pero yung temperament, I think this was already my temperament ever since. Pero yung strength siguro. Yung strength, yung lahat na hirap na pinagdaanan. Siguro I was even made more stronger by the death of my husband. Gaya po na sinasabi ko, Ngayon, pakiramdam ko kaya ko kahit ano. Kasi parati ko lang sinasabi ko, nakayanan ko ngayon pagkamatay ng asawa ko, nothing is more difficult than that. Kaya ko kahit ano.
Thank you. The last question is from Christine Sabilia of Inquirer.net.
Good afternoon, ma'am. Do you think the Liberal Party is doing enough to oppose policies of the administration? Former President Aquino has repeatedly refused to be critical. Senator De Lima has become a victim of harassment, undermining her attempts to oppose Duterte. It seems like most of the weight now is on you. Is the LP keeping quiet because they are just afraid of being accused of Plan B? And do you think that is enough reason? And finally, will you convince the others to support leaders like you and De Lima who are willing to speak out?
As you can see, it's a very simple question.
I think the LP is not doing enough at this point. And naiintindihan ko naman kung bakit. Gaya ng sabi ko kanina, parang nabulaga din kasi yung LP. We were the majority party before. Parang yung very complacent. Di ba? Parang naging very complacent because the president was a part of the Liberal Party. Parang nakaasa lahat doon. And when this thing happened, walang handa. Gaya ng sabi ko, hindi siguro inaasahan ng partido na malalagasan kaming ganun kadami. Di ba? Parang ang biruan nga sa loob, kasya na sa isang Volkswagen. Sa unti. Pero parang we were so used that we were so many, we were so used to the fact that we were the dominant party and all of a sudden, ganun lang naman yung buhay, di ba? Nasa taas, nasa baba, ngayon nasa baba. And we were not prepared for it. Kaya parang alam mo yon, parang nabigla at dahil nabigla walang hindi nakapag-react ng maayos. Pero right now, because you already have an interim president, meron na kaming interim secretary general, sa informal talks, there is already a plan to convene the party first quarter of 2017. It's a little too late, pero...
You said earlier, maybe January, you said?
Maybe, actually, yung unang pag-uusap, ang usapan, March. Pero yung usapan kagabi, baka too late na yung March, baka mag-usap na tayo in January kasi there are so many issues already that the party needs to take a stand, whether for or against it.
Ma'am, it's 2 minutes past our, but can you entertain one more question? I don't know if the question will be entertaining, but well, the question is from our research director, Minor Generalao.
Good afternoon po. My question really simple and very mundane. Because I'm a newly licensed real estate broker. So my question is, you mentioned that there's big problems in the housing sector. What's the biggest problem? And I will share you some of the concerns of brokers that maybe there will be a lot of uncertainty in the housing sector in the days to come.
Actually, ma'am, it would need another hour to enumerate the problems in the housing sector because there is really too much. Pero siguro, just to encapsulate it, we have a 5.6 million backlog, but we're producing only an average of 200,000 houses a month, which means that if we don't think out of the box, if we don't get out of status quo, you'll be left with an exponential increase of, di ba, yung housing backlogs at the end of the term. Ang tingin ko kasi, ma'am, yung number one, parang yung metrics ng gobyerno yung mali. Yung metrics ng gobyerno for a very long time, number of houses built. Hindi nabigyan ng DN yung urban development. So yung pagpaplano ng mga relocation sites, pagpaplano ng everything, parang on a per site basis, which I think is terribly wrong. So ngayon, yung aming balak sana, we already met with the Metro Manila mayors, yung aming balak magkaroon ng isang comprehensive ng pagpaplano ng buong Metro Manila. Meron na po kaming inventory ng lahat na available na government properties. Mag-a-identify na kami, may listahan na ng mga, parang nandun na kami sa matching. Ang dami po nating mga relocation sites na unsuccessful. Unsuccessful dahil tinapon lang ng tinapon sa labas, walang tubig, walang kuryente, walang access to livelihood, no access to public transportation. Ang ginagawa po, iniiwan lang yun dati, bumabalik sa Metro Manila as informal settlers again. So building houses outside Metro Manila doesn't really solve the problem. So yung sa akin po sana, yung entire change of mindset, yung halughugin yung policy, we have started doing that already. Na paplanuhin ang kabuuan, hindi yung patsi-patsi. Kasi parang nangyari po dati, parang ano lang, sige lang, mga contractor yung naghahanap ng mga sites, which is wrong, kasi kulang yung empathy sa mga beneficiaries. Yung pinapasundan po sana namin ngayon, people-driven na housing projects, which means na from the very start, kabahagi na yung tao sa pagpaplano. Tinatanong na yung tao kung okay sa kanila yung site na lilipatan sa kanila, yung design ng bahay, etc. Masyado marami pong problema. But also, government policies should be more encouraging for real estate developers. Kasi sa hirap po ng pag-a-apply ngayon, walang gustong pumasok sa socialized housing. Kasi konti yung kita, napakahirap pa ng proseso. So ngayon po gusto sana nating gawing attractive para sa tao na pumasok sa socialized housing. Yung wish ko lang, sana yung nasimulan mapatuloy para hindi na tayo back to square one.
Okay, and on that note of continuity, we have to call it a day. Unfortunately, that's all the time we have. We'd like to call on our president who will hand over the tokens of our appreciation.